What a beautiful day to be out and to, a beautiful day to have you, and I'm glad you chose to come to the library rather than to go somewhere else. Possibly you're going on a beautiful. My name is Lady Knight, and we're so happy to see you all and to have a visit today from a young woman who was very kind to sort of step in after we had a cancellation. But I mean, it was a while ago that she said yes, but we were very happy she said yes, and her name is Cassandra Hafner. Actually, I have to give credit to Connie Dunham, who is a friend of ours and who has a company called Hampton's Staffing. Is that what it is?
Mm-hmm.
And Connie referred us to Cassandra, so thank you, Connie, as well. And we'll add that Cassandra's husband, Grant, is here. Hello, Grant. Grant is a painter, so watch for his name. Anyway, Cassandra told me a little bit about herself. She was born in Spain, actually. Her father was in the Navy, so they moved around quite a bit. Her parents had spent 10 years in Italy prior to that, so they became good cooks, interested in great food. So she grew up in a household that appreciated and loved good food. They moved to New Haven, and then she did most of her growing up in Toms River, New Jersey. When she was 25, she landed in the Caribbean, in St. John, nice place to live, and worked there for 3 years, and then in 2004 came up to the East End of Long Island, where she has been ever since. And her first job when she arrived here was cooking. She has worked for Time and Again for quite some time. And she also has done cooking for Anna Pump, Loaves and Fishes, which is such a great organization and produces very good food. She's a self-taught cook. She also teaches, she's the weekend chef at the Ross School. And so she cooks, and this is something I didn't know, but she cooks for about 190 people every weekend. The kids who are boarding, which I had no idea, they had so many boarders, and the people who sort of mind them, the kind of house parent people. So she's very active, and plus she has her own sort of little private catering, private cooking, private chef company. So take a business card if you'd like. Anyway, we're really grateful to you, Cassandra, for coming here today. Please welcome Cassandra Hafner.
Thanks, Penny. Thanks, everybody, for coming. And thank you, Connie, for thinking of me. It's a great show of confidence. Like Penny said, I'm a self-taught cook. And when I first started working for that catering company, Time and Again, it was like the light bulb that went off in my head. And I was like, oh, this is a job that I don't mind doing 15 hours a day. It's really rewarding. It's very rewarding to feed people. It makes most people really happy. And so it's kind of a, you know, self-complimentary job. And I get to feed myself and my loved ones as I do it. Like Penny said, I've lived here for almost going on 10 years. We've lived in North Haven for the past 3 years. We've been really happy there. I started out at Time and Again. I worked for Eli's A Bar for a little while. I worked at a country club for a little while. I came to the conclusion that I sort of would prefer to be my own boss, and that's when I started looking for some private chefing. And I worked for an amazing family last summer that really boosted my confidence. And, you know, I didn't think that I could love cooking anymore, but I ended up even happier with my choice of field. And at the Ross School, it's a really amazing experience because everybody that's worked there has worked there for like 10 years or more. And so there's some great mentoring that goes on. And we utilize all local and organic ingredients. So I feel like I'm doing a really important thing by feeding children healthy, well-rounded food. We compost there. We have a garden there. And so it's a really exciting place to be. I hope I'm there for like another 10 years, as well as doing my private cooking, because that's where all of the fun is, where I get to create my own menus, where I get to develop my own relationships with people. Because that's part of, you know, cooking is it's an act of love. And so when you get to share it with people, it magnifies that act of love so much. Today we're going to do a little brunch demonstration. We're going to make four different dishes. Two of the dishes are going to be chicken salads because I thought it would be really interesting to talk about how one ingredient can be really versatile. You can change the flavor profile with just a few different things. The first dish that we're going to do is an herb chicken salad. And I've never done this before, so bear with me if I, falter a little bit. I like to use organic products. I realize that it's a little more expensive, but when you think about the quality of food that you're putting into your body, it just makes such a difference. In cooking, my level of nutrition personally has jumped by leaps and bounds. And I've started making much better decisions about what I put in my body because I'm thinking about what I'm putting into his body, but I'm thinking about what I'm putting into the kids' bodies. And if you start with good ingredients, you come out with a good product. If you start with tasty ingredients, you're pretty much guaranteed a good result. Simple is usually better. You don't have to have a list that's 4 pages long of ingredients to make a really good dish. For example, the frittata has basically 4 different ingredients in it, and it's delicious. The herb chicken salad, I like to start off with bone-in chicken breasts and roast it. I feel like it creates the best flavor. I salt and pepper it with a little bit of olive oil, and I roast it for maybe about 400 degrees, and then I let it come to room temperature. You always want to test your chicken, make sure it's gotten cooked enough. You always want it to reach 160 degrees, and then you can make sure that there's no lingering microbes or any funky stuff in there. We all want to shy away from that. Another thing that I thought was interesting is that you can change the texture of your dish by cutting it different ways. For example, on the herb chicken salad, which is down there, I tore the chicken into small pieces. And in the other chicken salad, the chicken curry chicken salad, I cut it up into small pieces. And you'll see why each texture flows with that particular dish. And that can be carried over into the other ingredients as well. Like for instance, with the celery that I put into the chicken salad, with the herb chicken salad, it's sort of in strings. And so I cut the celery on a bias, which is just what that means is you just cut it on an angle. You can cut it as thin or as thick as you like. I cut it a little bit thin because I find that celery adds a really nice texture and I like the flavor, but there's a nice portion of the population out there that's not crazy about celery. So I don't want it to be overbearing. So that's pretty much how I did that, because it kind of looks like my chicken. And then you have that sort of fluidity of texture. Also in the herb chicken salad, I put grapes, because I think grapes, I'm a big fan of the sweet and the savory flavor composition. And so I like to use red grapes for the color. They really make a nice pop. I cut them in half, because that way, they're already sort of broken down a little bit, and then when you pop it into your mouth, it's not like squishing out. It's already part of that bite that you're taking. I don't know if that, I guess it makes sense. So I do red grapes, and then I also do a plethora of herbs. I do fresh thyme, and I like to use fresh herbs for everything. And one of the reasons I like to use herbs is that they impart an enormous amount of flavor. They're pretty much calorie-free. So part of healthy cooking is to put flavor in there, because if you're trying to cook healthy and eat healthier, you have to want to eat the food. It's a conscious decision about what you're putting in your body. Herbs are the best flavor ever. They're also, and a lot of people say, well, herbs are really expensive. They're not expensive if you grow them, and they're really easy to grow. If you have a sunny spot in your house, you can grow thyme all year long. I've had a thyme plant that's been growing for about a year and a half. Starting in the summertime, bring them in. The woodier herbs tend to last the wintertime. The tender herbs like tarragon or parsley might not make it, but they will come back the next year, which is really cool. So, I mean, we probably save $400 or $500 a year by growing our own herbs, I would say. So I put fresh thyme. I put tarragon, which to me, tarragon and chicken are like peanut butter and jelly. I think that they go so well together. I think that the flavors just meld into, they're just good. And tarragon is sort of licorice-y and minty at the same time, so it's also kind of potent. You want to be a little bit sparing with it. You might want to try it out and put some in at first, and then decide how much you want to put in the end. And also realize that the flavors come out more as it sits, and something like a chicken salad, you do chill it for a period of time. You want to get those flavors really melded. So it's okay to err on the side of caution and hold back a little, because you can always add a little fresh herbs at the end. The texture is fine that way. Another herb that I like to put in, which is kind of overlooked, is celery leaves. Celery leaves kind of taste like celery for the most part. They add a brightness, they're a little bit lemony, and it's something that, you know, you save a little money again because you're not throwing away a product that comes with every head of celery that you buy. So this has a bunch of celery in it. It has fresh parsley, which as a kid I hated, but now I realize that it's completely integral. It adds this sort of mellow sweetness at the end of your dishes. The color's beautiful. You can buy curly parsley, you can buy flat-leaf parsley, whatever your preference is. Which is also one of the fun things about cooking, is that you can always adapt it to what you like to eat. You can take a recipe and make it one time, and then you can be like, but I think I'd like it better this way, which is what I do all the time. So I shredded the chicken, I cut the celery, I halved the grapes, I chopped all my herbs, and then for the dressing, I got some olive oil mayonnaise because it's a little bit lower in fat. I love the flavor of olive oil, so it's not much of a difference to me. I don't use much mayonnaise in my cooking, so I'd rather have it taste good. I mixed some olive oil. I zested a lemon. This is the best tool ever for zesting. You can just go right across. You never have to worry about getting too far into the zest because, you know, when you're zesting citrus, you never want to get to that white part. It's really, really bitter. That's what you call the pith. If you've gotten into that, it's just going to make everything taste better. But the zest of citrus, the zest of lemons, is a pretty invaluable ingredient because there's very few things in my mind that a little hit of lemon doesn't help, you know. If your dish at the end tastes a little too salty, a little hit of lemon brings it up. And it's nice and bright, you know, it's kind of like invokes a little bit of springtime into the dish, which is definitely what we're feeling today. So then I mixed up my dressing. And I do this dressing separately because it can get a little cumbersome to try and mix everything together, little spots and clumps of things. So I like to mix the dry ingredients together, make the dressing, and then mix it all up. I always add a little salt and pepper to the dressing, and then I taste it and I adjust as I need to. I don't use table salt for anything. I usually use sea salt or kosher salt for cooking. And fleur de sel is always really nice for finishing. And so that's the herb chicken salad. It's really nice and light. It's got that sweet, savory balance, and I thought that in between we'll just taste each dish as we talk about it. So if you guys want to come up and taste the herb chicken salad, please be my guest. But should we start? Why don't we have a little so that each table can eat together?
Okay.
Why don't we start with you guys, and we'll just kind of sweep around. Is that okay?
Wedding style.
Wedding style. We'll help you first. Everybody grab a plate. We might want to hold on to the plates just to be nice to the environment.
Thank you.
So I'm not quite sure what I'm gonna do.
Okay, we're ready for snack attack?
I just got a mixture of like.
Doesn't this look good?
Thank you. grow, okay, we moved to Brooklyn about 2.5 We, how I got involved with Inclusion Systems, I think it's all, yeah, I've never been to your home. I'm sure it's great, there was things about it. I do believe it. Now I give it to you. Okay, so have a seat. All right, moving on. Hurry, take a salad. Okay. So with the first chicken salad, I did the same roasting, bone and breast. The bone gets a lot of flavor, retains a lot of the moisture of the chicken, and it's often less expensive than deboned chicken because less work has been put into it. And I also think that that's important because the less fabrication that's gone into your products, the less hands that have touched them. The less hands that have touched your food, the better in all areas. In my curry chicken salad, I like to use a lot of flavors that sort of embody that sort of sweet, spicy, salty flavor profile of Indian food. I like to use a Madras or a West Indian curry powder for this because they're sweeter. It's really important to taste your curry powders. They're all made from different ingredients. There's tons of different regional blends of curry powders. The Madras curry powder and the West Indian curry powder are pretty similar. They are yellower in color, so that's one way to recognize it. But it's something that you can taste test, and it lasts a while in the pantry, so don't be worried about buying 2 or 3 and then figuring out what you want to do with it. I put in dried cranberries, I put in golden raisins. I use golden raisins a lot instead of regular dark raisins, again, because I find the color more appealing, and we eat with our eyes, first and foremost. With the celery, because I cut my chicken into chunks, I like to cut the celery into chunks. And if you guys see how I'm cutting the celery, I keep my fingers curled under always. And I cut out the ribs. Another thing you can do if you're a person who has who gets irritated by fibrous things, like, you know, sometimes bell pepper skins or celery strings, you can always take your peeler and shave off the strings of the celery before you cook it, and it makes it a little bit more easier to digest. So these guys I just cut into little cubes. And this is what you call a dice, which you probably know. And what I did, and I did that because I wanted all the textures, again, to be the same. I have the small pieces of chicken, I have the small pieces of celery, I have the cranberries and raisins, and I also put a little bit of onion in there. And with the cranberries and the raisins, with dried fruits, I do prefer to rehydrate them, which is also a really fun thing where you can impart flavor again. What you want to do is you want to take a hot liquid pretty much near boiling, and you want to submerge your dried fruits in there. You can flavor it. Yesterday, when I reconstituted my cranberries and my raisins, I put a bay leaf and some star anise and a cinnamon stick in with the hot water, because you're just going to infuse that much more flavor in it. You could use a fruit juice if you want it to be really more potent fruity flavor. You could use white wine, or you could do like half and half with a liqueur and water. As long as it's hot, you're gonna see them plump up pretty fast. It takes about 10-15 minutes, that's all. And then you drain off the liquid, and you've got your nice soft fruits. And another thing I wanted to mention about curry powder is that you have to cook it to get all of the aromatic flavor out of it. If you add straight curry powder to your dish, it has a little bit of grainy texture. So what I do for the curry chicken salad is I saute the onions that I'm gonna use with the curry powder and a little bit of turmeric, because turmeric is what gives that nice yellow color. Curry powder itself doesn't necessarily make it so bright and vibrant. It also gives it a little bit more of a spicy flavor profile, which I think is very complimentary to the dish. So I cook that with the curry powder, the turmeric, and the onions, just a little bit of grapeseed oil. And then I add apples to it, because I also put apples into my curry chicken salad. It's all about that sweet, savory thing. The apples I like to put into the end because I want to retain some of their texture. I want a little bit of that bite in there. So I let the onions and the curry cook down almost all the way. And while they're cooking, I utilize that time to peel my apples and dice them. And so it's also about fitting things in and having the fluidity of your task. I try to always make sure that I have something going while I'm doing something else. The key is to not overwhelm yourself and have five things going and have five other things on deck. So that always, that comes with practice. Practice makes perfect in that. And then the last part of the curry chicken salad that I think is really important, instead of using mayonnaise, I use yogurt. Yogurt is an intrinsically Indian ingredient, and it's, I find almost no flavor difference between full fat and low fat and fat-free yogurt. So I use fat-free yogurt in here. It has a little bit looser of a consistency than some of the full fat yogurts, but that's fine. If you wanted it to have a little bit more richness, you could mix in a little bit of olive oil, which is, I believe, how I wrote it out in the recipe. And when you think of Indian food, you think of the spicy curries, and you think of the lassis that they drink, the yogurt drinks. You think about the yogurt-based sauces like the raitas. And so it just seemed like a natural thing that instead of using mayonnaise for the curry chicken salad, that I would turn to yogurt. But it also gives it a nice sharp little bite because you have a lot of like richness and earthiness going on, and you have a lot of fruitiness going on. And so that light tang of the yogurt really balances everything. If you wanted to, you could finish it with a little bit of parsley. And you just mix it all up again. Actually, this one's a little different. I got the chicken in there, I got the fruits in there, I got the celery in there, and I poured the onion apple curry mixture over it and then put the yogurt and tossed it all together. One other point that I want to make about the chicken salads is that it's really important to refrigerate them pretty much overnight. Chicken salad is a great thing to do the day ahead. That way you don't have to worry about it when you're feeding people. It's already done. And the flavors really come together. The longer they can sit together, the better. Doesn't mean you want to let it sit for 3 days. It's chicken. It's highly perishable. And that's curry chicken salad. You guys want to come up and try it? Something that I grew up with because my parents spent time in Italy. It was a good leftovers meal. If you had eggs in the house and you had leftover pasta or leftover vegetables, you can make frittata and an oven proof pan. You need an oven proof pan. So we live in a really great area where we get really nice eggs. And I do usually take the time and the money to buy a really nice egg. There's a couple reasons for that. The flavor is always superior. The color is always superior. You don't have to worry about microorganisms like salmonella and E. coli quite as dutifully. I do try to rinse my eggs. You're always supposed to crack your eggs flat and not on the side because you don't want anything that could be attached to the egg going inside into the liquid of the egg. My parents in New Jersey have chickens, and so they have fresh eggs, and that's when I fell in love with having fresh eggs. It makes a huge difference in the quality. And eggs, speaking of, they started talking about eggs and how bad they were, like back in the late 80s and 90s, and how we're not supposed to have eggs every day. But as it turns out, eggs are a pretty good, complete protein. If you're looking for protein, it's a better way to have protein than red meat, you know, or a lot of the processed meats that we eat. So I've gone back to eggs. I think that eggs are not so bad to eat in moderation. Are you supposed to have four, and are they supposed to be fried with four pieces of bacon? No. But you can have a nice scrambled egg with some onion and a little bit of Parmesan cheese and some fresh fruit for breakfast, and you're really doing all right. With the eggs, I just scramble them. I put a little salt and pepper in them. You can, if you're one of those people that likes to put water or cream in your eggs to lighten it, that's fine. Again, that's about preference and you're cooking, so you get to do what you want. I love tomatoes and eggs. I think they really go really great together. I use grape tomatoes in this dish, and what I did was I blistered them. And when I blister them, it just concentrates all that flavor. Like, we know the difference between cooked tomato and raw tomato and how it tastes. And so at this time of year, when tomatoes are not actually in season, I think it's a great idea to cook them if you're going to use them. So I bring a pan till it's screaming hot. I put a little grapeseed oil in there. I use grapeseed oil because it has the highest smoke point. You can cook it to over 400 degrees and it's not going to burn or become carcinogenic. It doesn't impart any flavor. It also has some good anti-cancer qualities. And so I toss the tomatoes into that screaming hot pan. They pop, they scream, They make a lot of noise. You shake them around, and you just cook them until you start smelling that sweet tomato smell. The skins are going to be a little charred. They're going to be a little blackened. The tomatoes are going to break down a little bit, which I think is also nice for a cooked dish because you're not having that raw tomato texture in with your cooked product. So once I have those done, I let them cool down a little bit because it's just easier to handle. And that's when I start whipping my eggs up. So I cook the tomatoes, I start whipping the eggs up, I start grating the cheese. For this frittata, I use a 5-year-old Gouda, which is a cow's milk cheese from Holland. It's delicious. I'm sorry, I lied. It's a 4-year-old Gouda. It comes in different years. This one was a 4-year-old Gouda. It is super sweet, salty, and caramelly. It has the most amazing flavor. It's somewhere between a firm and a hard cheese, so it doesn't completely melt down. So I think it has that fun texture. I did bring one that I didn't cut up yet for you guys to see. And so I grated that up. And another cool thing about the aged Gouda is it has these calcium lactate crystals in it. So if you're eating it on a cheese board, it has these little crunchies. And not much cheese has texture. And it's just delicious. It's got, you give a little, it's also really great with sliced apple. Apple and cheese is one of the best nuts in the world for me. So I've rinsed out my pan and cleaned it out. I put it back on the heat. I have it at about medium high. And then I add my eggs to it. I add a little grapeseed oil and a little bit of butter for flavor because I think that eggs cooked in butter do have kind of a nicer flavor than just with oil. And what I do is, we've all probably done this, but as you're cooking, you know, you've got your eggs in there, they're starting to get hard around the edges, and you pull up the edges and let the liquids come to the edge. And you do that all around, do that all around, do that all around, until you only just have a little bit of liquid left on top. And that's when I add my other guys. That's when I put the tomatoes all around. I sprinkle fresh oregano over the top because I think that the oregano and the tomato and the Gouda have a really nice flavor profile. Food of the Mediterranean, except for the Gouda, not really Mediterranean. Just think of the oregano and tomatoes, I think, are very good friends. And I put the oregano, and I kind of put the oregano under the cheese so that it wouldn't just stay on top and perhaps burn in the oven. I keep the oven at about 400 degrees. This was a 12-egg frittata, so it took a little longer than what you'll see on your menu. This took about 20-25 minutes in the oven. And so I just put everything on top, I threw it in the oven, and you can watch it, and it's like magic. It just starts puffing, and it's almost like souffle-like, and when you take it out of the oven, it's like sizzling, and everything's melted. Everything's come together into this sort of pizza-like, cute little pie. And then it sort of deflates. And it's a great brunch item because eggs are just fine at room temperature. If you were just cooking it for your family and you eat it right hot out of the oven, that's awesome too. And I just think it's really amazing that that's four ingredients. Cheese, tomatoes, eggs, herbs, a little bit of oil. Four ingredients, and you've got a really impressive egg dish. It's so much better than a fried egg. Yes?
What about the cheese?
You could use cheddar. You could use goat cheese. I think goat cheese and spring vegetables in a frittata, like a little asparagus and goat cheese and fresh thyme would be amazing. If you wanted something a little bit richer, say you have some leftover grilled eggplant, I would use some grilled eggplant and maybe some provolone. You know, I think I would always try and match the cheese with whatever ingredient I was putting in there, whatever its little play date was going to be inside the frittata. Yep.
I heard you mention, and I think I see up there, you can serve it at room temperature.
Sure.
So if you were going to make this, say, for a brunch party,
mm-hmm.
you could make, well, how would you do that?
I would preferably cook it that morning and just let it be room temperature. And it makes things a lot easier. You know, and during service, if you don't have to serve absolutely everything hot. If you were having a brunch, you could have the frittatas done and cooked up and cut up. And then, and say you were also making pancakes. That way your focus could be on the pancakes and keeping them out and refilling that platter to order instead of, I think that's going to keep a lot better than, say, your pancakes or your French toast or something like that.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Oh, about the grapeseed oil. I noticed you use that.
I do use grapeseed oil a lot.
And what is the preference over using olive oil or another point?
It has a higher smoke point. You can heat it a lot hotter. It's also a neutral oil. It doesn't impart any flavor. It doesn't really taste like anything. And so sometimes olive oil can have a little bit of a cloying flavor. Sometimes it just overbears the other flavors. And so sometimes you just want the fat, you want the function of the fat instead of the flavor.
How long can you keep grapeseed oil? And do
you can keep it in the refrigerator indefinitely. It is one of the ones, it's perishable just like any oil, and so if you're not going to run through, I don't keep it in the refrigerator because I go through it really quickly. But if you're a weekend cook, just keep it in the refrigerator and you take it out maybe 20 minutes before you're going to use it to let it, because it will solidify, just to let it start liquefying again.
And is it available in the supermarket?
Yeah, it sure is. It's right next to the olive oils. It's in King Cullen. It used to be sort of a specialty item, but it's really not so much. And guess what? It's not any more expensive than olive oil. So it's also cost effective. And it's I think that it goes through less of a refining process than, say, like Wesson vegetable oils. And also, again, has some nutritional qualities.
Can you use that then for baking instead of a Wesson oil?
Sure.
No flavor?
Yep. Absolutely. All right, who wants to try frittata? I also like it because it has many marshmallows in it. Wait till that bake settles down. And it just makes it easier to eat. Like, who does want to eat any of that, like, membranous, bitter stuff? So you cut the top and the bottom off your orange. You want to make sure that you cut to the fruit, because what you're trying to do is getting rid of all of that white pith and the peel. And then you just cut it down the sides, trying not to take off too much fruit, because you don't want to waste the fruit. You know, again, practice makes perfect with this kind of thing. When I first did this, I probably was left with about a quarter of the orange. But now, I only take off that much. So once you've got all of the peel off, and then I go around and I trim any of the white pith off that might be there, and you can really see the segments of the orange. And what you do is you just simply, and you need a really sharp knife for this. I can't impress upon you the importance of keeping your knife sharp and how much easier it makes your life and how much more fun it makes cooking to have a sharp knife. The best thing I ever did was take my tax return a few years ago and buy myself a set of really awesome knives. And I'm still in love with them. Levels. So you go down one side of the membrane and then down the other side of the membrane. And then it just falls out like that. And that's
kind of, we won't want to do this while holding the orange, would we?
No, you do. You kind of have to hold the orange. And so you just take it slow. Slow as a pro, you know, and practice it. And a smaller knife is fine. You can use a knife this big. You don't have to use a knife this big. And then you just keep going through like that. You know, and this really only takes a couple minutes. When I eat a grapefruit in the morning, I do this. And start, instead of trying to dig through it with one of those like corrugated spoons that don't really actually work that well. And as you see, like, I can do this pretty quick. It's not too hard. And then you just have a nice golden sunny piece of orange with nothing tough and nasty to try and eat through or get stuck in your teeth that you have to pick out later, because that's an issue. We don't ever like to pick things out of our teeth. One of the other ingredients that I like to put into my ambrosia fruit salad is pomegranate seeds. Pomegranate seeds are like a magic fruit. They're super duper good for you. They have a plethora of vitamins and minerals in them. They're good for your heart. They're good for your digestion. They're good for stroke prevention. They're good for diabetes. There's a bunch of things
I wrote them all down. Skin allergies, urinary tract infections, sore throats, blood impurities, like the pomegranates are amazing. They're a little bit daunting for people sometimes because they're all those yummy seeds are enveloped in that membrane of skin. So what I learned with pomegranates is that you can cut it into quarters actually, have a bowl with some cold water in there, and then work the seeds through the skin, through that thin little membrane. The seeds will float up to the top and they'll separate from the membrane, and it's just a lot easier than trying to like pick them out one by one over a bowl. And it also sort of cleans and refreshes them as you're doing it. So that's my trick with pomegranate seeds. And when I was a kid, I used to spit out the pits of the pomegranate seeds, but they also have nutritional value too. And so if they're the kind of thing that you're gonna get stuck in your teeth, or if you're worried about digestion, you can do it like an olive pit and spit it out. But I just eat the whole thing now. Doesn't bother me so much. So I've got my pomegranate seeds, I've got my oranges, I've got blackberries and strawberries I chose because I think that the colors balance really nicely with each other. If the blackberries are like summertime blackberries, they can be twice this size. Sometimes I cut them in half. Strawberries, when they're huge like this, if they're teeny strawberries, I might put them in whole. But otherwise, I would do this. You want to think about how much can somebody get on their fork at one time, and you want to make it manageable. And so I think about that all the time as I'm like, I think to myself as I'm cooking, like, why am I cutting up like this? Oh, because I want it to fit on a fork. You know, when you're making soup, you don't want to have huge pieces of something in there because you want it to fit on somebody's soup spoon. So with a strawberry this size, I'd probably cut it into about 6 pieces. So it's more like that. And then it's also sort of equivalent of your orange, of your blackberry. Like, everything sort of fits together. Also in the fruit salad, I like to put coconut. And I use unsweetened, all-natural coconut instead of the really sugary stuff that comes in the bakery aisle. And you can find it with the dried nuts and the dried cranberries. I think the Zini makes a product. There's a lot of different things out there right now. It still has all that nice, rich coconut flavor, but it doesn't have all that sugar. And we have sugar taco first. And this is a fruit salad. It's already pretty darn sweet. You don't need to add a whole bunch of sugar. What I do add a little sweetness to is the sauce that I dress my fruit salad in. And this fruit salad also has mini marshmallows in it, so you still don't need to add that much more sugar to it. I like the mini marshmallows. They get really nice and soft. I think that they're a nice little counterpoint. I think it's just something, it's a sweet little treat at the end of your brunch. It's fun. You know, kids will like it. Kids will eat their fruit if it's mixed with marshmallows. And if you're not, there wasn't anything altogether too unhealthy in the rest of the meal, so you can indulge a little bit. It's, you know, cooking is about balance. The sauce is creme fraiche, which I just like the flavor. I like that with slight little tang. I like how rich and creamy it is. I lighten it by putting, once I'm done supreming my oranges, I squeeze all the juice that's left in the segments, because there's still a lot of yummy juice in there. I mix the orange juice, the fresh orange juice, with my creme fraiche, and then I add a little bit of honey to it as well, just to sort of balance out the flavor. Then I toss it all together, and that's Ambrosia fruit salad. Everybody always likes it. Come on and try it.
You make it ahead of time.
You can make it ahead of time with the exception of the berries. Berries I always put in last minute because they tend to sort of weep and lose their moisture. And you know, then you get that sort of liquid at the bottom of the bowl that isn't as palatable. I'd like to thank everybody for coming. This is really exciting and fun for me. I've never done anything like this before, so it's really cool. Everybody's really happy. Thank you all. Now don't forget, business card if you want, flyer for the next memorable meal in April. And I don't think we have a June one out yet, but we know we look forward to seeing you at all these memorable meal programs. Cassandra, this was a wonderful, memorable meal, and it was obvious that you went through a lot of trouble to do it, and I think we all love this food. So thank you.